For the next talk, we have our young dynamic chairman of the ARC, Dr. Chitra Ramamurthy, who is going to be speaking to us about why smile is a better bet compared to traditional methods of laser vision correction. Dr. Chitra.
Thanks, Dr. Praveen. At the very outset, in the background of the differing technologies which are there and contesting and competing with each other, it seems relevant that we have an evidence-based understanding of why smile stands strong amongst them. Essentially, there have been hurdles here. There is a lack of uniformity in the reporting outcomes. There are lack of RCTs, and the meta-analyses are of low quality. However, the comparison of smile against LASIK is going to be compared in these seven segments. Going further, it is seen that in different meta-analysis, the refractive outcomes when you compare SMILE to LASIK is equally efficacious and equally predictable, but there are certain limitations in SMILE. We all are aware that there is no tracking device or registration, no cyclotorsion compensation. And the treatment here, unlike in eczema, which is centered on the pupil center, here it auto-centers on the visual axis. However, said then, a small difference in the pupil center and visual axis does not indicate a decentered dot. So the next important thing we need to look into the astigmatism. We do know that undercorrection of astigmatism is a bit of a bugbear in SMILE, but then in any other procedure too, it depends on the magnitude of cylinder correction, the presence of anal kappa. If there's significant ocular residual astigmatism, the head positioning is not appropriate, the docking is not done well, and if the lenticule extraction is not complete. But keeping this in mind, different proponents have come forward to tell us that there is 10 to 12% undercorrection of SMILE, which occurs more so in higher grades of astigmatism. But having said that, a comparison was done between SMILE and femtolasic in different studies, which showed that there were undercorrections even in femtolasic, and this was not statistically different. However, suggestions have come up about manual compensation, triple marking centration, the consideration of 10% increment in the refractive cylinder value which was entered, which could be made as a standardized treatment protocol. When we talk of manual cyclocotorsion compensation with a triple centration technique, you have the patient sitting on the sit lamp and you mark the 3 o'clock, 6 o'clock and 9 o'clock positions. And then you have them when they lie down. When you dock, you ensure that the reticule comes to overlie the 3 o'clock, 9 o'clock position. But again, that although the results have been promising with lesser induction of higher order aberration or spherical aberration, in higher grades of astigmatism, there is no head-to-head comparison again. But the most effective role which SMILE plays is in the effective optic zone which it offers. We all know that in eczema, there is a peripheral energy loss and it becomes a smaller functional optic zone with induction of spherical aberration. And we all know that the effective optic zone size determines the area of greatest optical quality. And this is definitely reduced in femtosecond laser, LASIK as compared to SMILE. This was an older study where there were 100 eyes were compared for PRK, LASIK and SMILE by Dan Reinstein with equal pachymetry thickness and flap or cap equal thickness. And he professed that the SMILE was biomechanically stable. This probably encouraged the refractive surgeons to think that since SMILE lenticule is being removed from the deeper stroma, which definitely contributes less to the biomechanical stability, that we could probably treat higher myopic errors. But largely after understanding that our biomechanical tools are not that optimal, we would not try to treat more than -9 diopters when we are, even if we are doing a SMILE procedure. There were various studies which have come forward to say, claim with the existing biomechanical tools that the SMILE works favorably. We do understand that SMILE has a theoretical advantage of less weakening effect. It has inherent stronger biomechanics. And if you were to combine SMILE as a SMILE extra in some of these eyes at risk, the CRF has been found to be better. And the CXL has been found not only to cross-link the underlying stroma, but also the overlying cap.
1 minute.
And the evidence of cross-linking is there, which gives it an extra edge. If you look at the ectasia, there have been very few numbers in meta-analysis. And some of these eyes were preoperatively, it was not noted. However, there were many papers which come to claim that PRK strands better cryomechanically, then comes SMILE and then LASIK, but these changes are too subtle to warrant a change in the screening criteria. confocal microscopy again seems to show that there is some amount of stromal reaction in his, in some of these eyes earlier on. But these were more in those learning curves where there was a variability in setting the energy parameters and the surgeon skill. But something which stands to remember is that there's a large vertical cut, which we are doing a femtoelastic flap against the 3 mm to 5 mm cut with the SMILE incision. And this definitely ensures there's a less cutting of the nerve plexuses, and there's definitely less dry eye. In fact, there's a recovery of dry eye status after SMILE within a month as against a barren appearance with femtoelastic procedure. Again, at different time points, when you look at the tear breakup time or the subnasal nerve plexus or the corneal sensitivity or the tear osmolality, in all of these, SMILE scores over LASIK. If you look at the enhancement again in LASIK, it's 5 to 28% and just about 2.9% or less in SMILE. And the risk factors in SMILE are essentially patients over the age of 35, higher than minus 6 diopter, high astigmatism, and those who have had an intraop suction loss. And again, there are wonderful options which are there to consider if you're doing a SMILE enhancement. The most important and the last is that much discussed is a SMILE versus Contura. And there was one big study done by the Canalopolis where he claimed that Contura seemed to do better than SMILE. But we did a prospective study of 400 eyes wherein we found that both of them were equally predictable, equally safe, and equally efficacious. In fact, we looked at the higher order aberrations. The vertical coma was just a little more in SMILE and the spherical aberrations just a little more in Contura. In other words, the results seem to be equivalent. The residual error is a key factor. But most importantly, postoperatively, all patients who underwent SMILE seem to be more comfortable. So I would like to conclude stating that yes, SMILE is an excellent, safe, and predictable modality with immediate comfort and lack of dryness. Biomechanically, superiority seems to be likely, but that needs yet to be established with better, more sophisticated tools. Thank you.
Thanks a lot, Chitra. Lovely review of why SMILE is potentially better than LASIK. So if you have a patient in your clinic and you do both LASIK as well as SMILE, who asks you to make the decision for him if he's suitable for both LASIK and SMILE, what would you tell that patient?
Definitely, if in every way, if a patient is suitable for refractive surgery procedure, I would definitely advise him to undergo SMILE. The cost would be the only reason where I would open up more on the other options. Of course, all the options are equally discussed to the patient, but I would be more favorable for doing SMILE because I'm quite convinced that it is quite safe and there's an immediate recovery. And I would definitely, although I do agree on PRK being a treatment of great standing, but that initial discomfort which is there has to be kept in mind. So I would consider it more for those borderline cases wherein I would not suggest the other options. Femtoelastic, by the very fact that vertical cut is there, I would definitely keep it as a secondary option.
Perfect. Thank you.
I have a question for you. Can I ask?
Yes, sir. Yes, please.
Madam, if there's a borderline dry eye patient, would you do SMILE and not LASIK?
Borderline dry
eye. Because the risk of dryness post SMILE is much lesser. In which cases of borderline dry eye, would you do SMILE and not LASIK, or would you not do both?
No, I would do SMILE against LASIK.
In which cases, madam? Like, for example, there are cases where we would reject the patient outright.
Yeah.
But in which cases would you do SMILE but not LASIK?
I would do SMILE for all patients unless, of course, the dry eye is significant, then I would need
only dry eye with respect to dry eye.
Or there is some kind of a biomechanical, I feel it's a thinner cornea or those. Against femtoelastic, I would advise SMILE, excepting high cylinders.
No, ma'am, but only with respect to dry eye.
No, with
respect. Everything else being the same.
Yeah, with respect to dry eye, there's no doubt SMILE would perform better than femtoelastic. There's so much of cutting of nerve plexuses, there is no way I would suggest femtoelastic as against SMILE.
The other point I wanted to just discuss is that when we talk about biomechanics, we always talk about ectasia. But I think ectasia is more because of a pathology in the cornea. These are abnormal corneas. But when we look at biomechanics in terms of long-term stability, and you look at both LASIK and SMILE and the enhancement rates, we find that definitely with SMILE, the stability, long-term stability is much better. We have done over like 8,000 procedures now with SMILE, and our enhancement rates are just like 0.2% or so. With LASIK, it was 2.5%. And I think Rupal also has published, because she was one of the first to start SMILE. She's got probably the longest follow-up, and I'm sure she can also talk about this. So when you talk about biomechanics, it's also the long-term stability of the cornea rather than just ectasia.
Yeah, I agree with Dr. Shriganesh. When we talk about biomechanical strengthening, it is not just in the form of having ectasia. Ectasia per se is really in a very, very minuscule percentage of cases of all refractive surgery cases done all across the world with different platforms and different procedures. So ectasia is not the only thing that you are worried about. We're worried about the long-term stability. And definitely SMILE scores better. In fact, Dr. Chitra, I would, if there is a high cylinder, I would want to do SMILE rather than femtolasic, because I found the results to be definitely superior in terms of the stability of the outcome that you get. I also wanted to ask you, Dr. Chitra, is that one of your slides said that there is more danger in older patients, and is it something like that? I mean, why would you be more careful in older patients, or means, you know, there were like 3-4 points, and I didn't really get that.
What did you say? I didn't hear you. Older patients?
Yeah, you. One of your slides said that your
enhancement rates has been seen that are very few in SMILE, and that too it has been seen in patients who are older than 35, or if they have a myopia more than -6 or a high cylinder, or if they've had an intraop suction loss. These are the situations where there has been those limited enhancement rates. Praveen, question? Any other question?
So, anything else from the other panelists, Dr. Mahipal, Dr. Ramamurthy, would like to add, Dr. Himanshu, Namrata?
Can I just ask a question to the panel right now?
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Tell me, what is the, you know, I think the amount of dryness for LASIK has been overstated. Your cataract patients, all your cataract patients, how many of your cataract patients complain of dryness post-surgery?
We actually add...
With a 2.2 millimeter incision at the limbus or maybe the cornea, we have more patients complaining of dryness than in fact routine patients. I just want an answer from the panel. What do you think? You agree with me that it's being overstated?
Dr. Himanshu, that could also be because we're giving a lot of drops post-cataract surgery for a longer period. So that could also be because of that, and not just
And also the age group. If you look at the age group, the cataract patients are the older age group.
Older
many of them are postmenopausal women who naturally have dryness. So you can't really, it's not a comparison of apples to apples. It's like apples and oranges. So you can't really compare the two groups.
All right.
So any other question, Ramamurthy? You have anything to ask? Gaurav? Then now Dr. Namrata, warm welcome. Anything to add before we go on to our next speaker?